Fran again in the lab. And I've got something really special, something you probably won't find anywhere else on YouTube. It is what is arguably the first virtual reality system made for PC. It's called the VR Surfer, and this came out in 1995. It was designed for Windows 95, which I did not actually have in 1995. I was running Windows 3.1.1, and this actually will run on 3.1.1. And before people start making the comments and say, Fran, that's not true, this wasn't the first virtual reality system for PC, because I've gone to Wikipedia and I've read the whole thing, yada yada. Okay, it's true. You know, virtual reality, if you want to break it down to just, you know, stereoscopic reproduction, goes back to the 19th century and stereoscopes and everything. Viewmasters that we all had as kids are really considered a form of virtual reality. And 3D movies, you know, going back to the, I guess, the 1940s or 50s, you know, the two-color 3D movies were a form of virtual reality. And, you know, there were other, like, entertainment kind of simulations and simulated environments that were done in the 60s and 70s and such. Even, like, Douglas Trumbull's Show Scan, even though it wasn't stereoscopic, was a kind of virtual reality system. There have been many, but it really wasn't until the 80s that the term virtual reality was coined by Jaron Lanier, who actually I know because when I was living in New York and had my shop in Brooklyn, I got contacted by Jaron Lanier, and we actually got together a few times. I spent some time with him at his packed loft in Soho, which was just crammed with all kinds of exotic musical instruments. He even had his own personal pipe organ, which he would gladly play at even the slightest prompting, to which he, when he was slamming on his pipe organ, I was saying, what the hell are your neighbors think of this? He was like, whatever. but I spent, you know, time talking with Jaron Lanier about all kinds of different things. He was working on some projects and consulted with me on some things. And but I did get to know him. But he actually, like, created the term virtual reality and had his power glove system and everything. It was developed in the 1980s. But you know, in the 80s and 90s and early 90s, in order to do anything VR, you really had to have some really powerful computing power. And even, like, if you go on Wikipedia, you'll find that they'll talk about the Autodesk system, the cyberspace project. But, you know, honestly, I wasn't able to find really any info about, you know, how many of those systems they sold or who they sold them to or where they were used. You know, were they used by regular schmoes at home, or was it really just a platform that could be used in academia and industry and stuff like that? Because I wasn't able to find any references to software that, or like games, or, you know, or any kind of like application that they developed for the cyberspace project that was like sold. And I think that particular system, because of the way that it rendered the graphics and everything, you had to have, I mean, if you had one of the systems in 1992, you had to have like a packed system. You had to have the fastest possible processor. You had to have a math coprocessor, a compiler. You had to have graphics accelerators, stuff that, you know, wasn't just, you know, stuff you could buy off the shelf in 1992 in a PC. But the VR Surfer was different than that. I mean, when this came out, they were really trying to make a system that would run on any PC. And I know I had just a regular, like a regular PC that I bought, like, in 93, I guess. It was running 3.1.1. It wasn't a particularly fast PC. It didn't have a graphics accelerator or anything, and I was able to run this. Yeah, and so my history with VR Surfer is that the company was co-founded, I believe co-founded, by my former business partner, Merton Keniston, who I started Frantone with back in 1994. It was, you know, we started Frantone in Central PA, and because he had a business out there that I worked for, and we went together to make Frantone. And by 96, he sold his main business and moved out of Pennsylvania to work for a startup company, which ended up being V-Rex. And he was the VP of manufacturing for making this. And he sent me this early prototype, I guess, or first run VR system. And I ran this on my 311 PC for, you know, a year or two, I guess. So it did work. And I wanted to demo this, but I tried loading it on my larger XP system, and it just wouldn't initiate because it really made to run on 311 or Windows 95. And I was like, man, do I have a Windows 95 system? And the only computer that I still had that would possibly run it is my original Sony Vaio that I got in, I guess, the fall of 2000. And so even before I started making this video, I had to find out if I had a system that would even load this software, much less run it. So yesterday I went through and had to find out even if this Vaio would even boot up, because I had, like I said, this notebook was my original like Frantone factory computer back in 2000. I got it for the Wingberg shop. And I think that the last time that I know that I had this fired up was in 2007, when I took it to a trade show to run video at a guitar trade show. So I don't know if I have even booted this up since then. So I went and did all that yesterday. So let's go to the Wayback Machine to yesterday and find out, will it boot? My old Sony Vaio laptop, which it's been in storage for quite a long time, and but if it does boot up, then I can probably install the software. But I thought it would be interesting just to find out, even if this would turn on. And the very first thing I know off the bat is I want to take the battery out, because I definitely don't want to boot this up with the old battery in it. So that's going to be step one. Take a little bit of precaution. I hate working with bad batteries, old batteries, if they're leaky and everything. Put on some gloves and all that. Let's see here. Yep. All right. No leakage, but yeah, definitely don't want to fire up a 20-year-old lithium-ion battery, that's for sure. Battery's out. Everything's safe. And I gotta tell you, you know, this computer ages very well. This really was a really sexy laptop. I remember when I got it. Oh boy, it must have been. This was. I'm trying to think when I got this. I got this to be the office computer, the original office computer, in the Brooklyn Frantone factory in Waynesburg back in 2000. So I guess I would have gotten this probably December 2000, maybe. And yeah, but it, as I recall, it is running Windows 95, I believe. Now the next hurdle is going to be whether or not the power supply is going to work. Where's it? Hopefully the power supply won't blow up. But it is a Sony, so it's probably got some good caps in there. Oh, little spark. It's charging up. All right. Power supply doesn't seem to be getting hot. So, all right. Boy, will it boot? Oh, hard drives. Oh, oh, yes. Oh, here we go. Oh. Checking this. bias, shadow, check date and time settings. See, must check some bad. Well, I'm just gonna resume, boot up. Oh, Windows ME. Ah, I was wrong about that. I was wrong about the operating system. It was Windows ME. Wow, I'd forgotten all about Windows ME. Makes sense, bought it in 2000, so... Well, it'll be interesting to find out if the software will actually run on this thing. But if it does, I'll be able to do that other video. I'm just waiting to see if it actually gets to Windows boot up. Still going. Still going. It's, I don't know. Still checking the hard drive, but it's not up yet. Oh, okay. Okay. All right. Oh, got a cursor. Okay. Touchpad driver's up. Oh. Windows has updated your clock as a result of daylight savings time. Okay, sure, why not? Why not? Okay. Yeah, sure, you know, whatever. December 1987. Okay, well, you know, sure, whatever. Whatever you want to do there. Okay. It's interesting that the clock would begin in 1987 if it's Windows ME. It doesn't, seems like a bit of an oversight. Hey! It is alive! Wow. Got handed to Sony, I'll tell ya. Well, with all that fanfare, it still hasn't quite booted up. It gave us the tunes, but still giving me a green screen. Oh, I see a start menu button. Oh, okay. I don't know if I had a, well, I always put a, like a screen saver, like a background. I always have my own custom backgrounds on all my computers, so. But yeah, look at that, it is up. Almost. It's getting there. It's still going, it's still booting up. Wow. Up, here we go, icons. Still not 100% up. Wonder what it's doing. Obviously all this is because the battery was dead and the, I'm surprised it's such a long boot up. Still chattering, still going. Refreshing the screen. It is like watching paint dry. It really is. I'm sure you're waiting on bated breath as I am. I'm trying to think what kind of virus scan I had in this thing. I think it was Norton or McAfee, I'm not sure. Back in these days, I do remember that when it got to the point where I was still using this on the internet, that the even for, like, at this time, which I guess was, like, the early aughts, the virus protections was, it was still, like, taking up, like, more clock than, like, this particular computer, like, really had. And so I think that's one of the reasons I retired it, was that I really couldn't use it online anymore because it was just the, even the virus scan protection at the time was just taking up too many resources for this really to work. I think that's why I retired it. Oh, I got some more icons in the menu here. The battery's out. Yep, okay. The hard drive has stopped shuddering. All right. Well, I mean, I guess the answer is yes. I'm gonna try loading in the software, see if it'll run some applications. Let's see if it'll load. 25-year-old CD-ROM. Ah. It is working. It's loading it. All right. Yeah, I really don't remember anything about Windows ME. I imagine it would be backward compatible to 95. Oh, here we go. All right. It is loading up. Oh, yeah. Oh, this is great. All right, yes, I agree. Okay, sounds good to me. Oh, here we go. It is installing. Oh, just a screensaver. All right. That only took about an hour. Let's see here. Yes, I want to restart my computer now. Yes. Let's say yes. I want to restart my computer now. Second boot up. That's a good sign. All right. It looks like we're going to have a configuration issue here. Yeah, okay. Looks like we're going to have to run this in DOS. So, okay. So, yeah. Well, I guess I got to go back and read the manual. And now we're back to today. So, let me open this up, show you what's in the VR Surfer package before we even get started on opening up the software. Okay, here we go. This is the box, the way it came originally. VR Surfer, wireless 3D eyewear and battery included. Real 3D action games included. Let you interact with stereoscopic space. Test your skill in new dimension, yada yada. 46 plus CPU, CD-ROM drive, color monitor, VGA graphics card. Warning, this is important. Some people are sensitive to stroboscopic or flashing visual displays. If you experience discomfort or disorientation when using the glasses, discontinue use. If you are prone to seizures or, on the advice of a physician, should not view stroboscopic displays, do not use. Not recommended for children under 8 years of age. All right. So, I think we've passed that test. At least I have. So, all right. And ride the coolest wave to the third dimension. Mention. All right. Finally, affordable wireless stereoscopic 3D eyewear. I think that really was the appeal here because that Autodesk system, as far as I know, it cost quite a chunk of change. and this was, I don't know how much it cost, but I think this was, you know, in the area of very affordable. But yeah, you know, and it was basically designed that you could hook it up to computer or television. If you can use a VGA monitor or television set. V-Rex, an innovative world leader in 3D stereoscopic imaging, has a complete line of professional 3D stereoscopic products, from 3D LCD panels and projectors to 3D notebook computers and video cameras. So they did have, I guess, a whole line that they were coming out with at the time, not just this headset. V-Rex invented the exclusive patented Micropole TM optics, which is being used for advanced applications in scientific visualization, military telepresence, medicine, entertainment, architecture, training, simulation, and more. So, it also has this booklet. I'm gonna get into this booklet in a moment, but I wanna get into the core hardware here. Like I said, this was a first generation, so there was actually two levels of software this came with. This is the version 1.1, and then this was the, it's in on the computer, the version 1.2. And let's see, we got the warranty card. Oh, $500 V-Rex dollars. This coupon entitles the holder to $500 worth off the purchase of a V-Rex 3D camera. Cam 3000. Does anyone have one of the V-Rex 3D cameras? 3D projection system, VR 1000 or VR 2000 series. Does anyone have the 3D projection system, I wonder? But, very important here, coupon has no cash value. offer extended until June 30th, 1997. So, boy, I better act fast. And we've got limited warranty registration. Oh, I wonder if it's too late to send this in, too. You need an email. That newfangled email in 1995. How many of you had email in 1995? I did, but, you know. All right. VR Surfer, current and upcoming titles. VR Surfer 3D content for 1996. Descent 1 and Descent 2. I was running Descent 2. I don't know if it comes on this disc. I don't know if, because there's no mention of it. I don't know if it's bundled on this disc or if it was a separate disc that I've since lost. But I did have a Descent 2 to run with this system. Flight Unlimited, which is a 3D stereoscopic version of the popular flight simulation. Mayan Ruins PC. Slipstream 5000, Hovercraft game, Shattered Steel, Stereo VR, Stereoscopic PC Environment, Figure Studies, Whiplash, Auto Racing Simulation Game, Concerto in 3D, A Stunning Sight and Sound Animation, Hot Air Ballooning, Aspen Balloon Festival, 1996, includes PVO. So I guess that's video. Oh, so this is the PC stuff, and this is the video stuff. So I guess they had a version of this that would run off VCR that you could use the goggles for interlaced video. You know, it would use use alternating frames for the left, right. And there's a, I'll show you, there's a synchronizing module for the glasses. Robo Jones, the first installment of the continuing adventures of Robo Jones. Follow Robo, the robot, around the galaxy in a search for tasty jewels. A video. Did anyone have that? I've never heard of that. Space Rescue, fast-paced animated adventure to save a space station from certain peril. Windjammer, sailing in the Caribbean from Grenada and Antigua. Aboard three-masted schooners. So that's another. I guess that's another. You are there kind of virtual reality experience. A Mexican journey, video and PC. Wow, exotic locations. Travels in Guatemala. Another video and PC, sights and sounds. So I guess, you know, the sort of the virtual tourism was they were getting in this. Pre-Christmas VRX exclusive, and many more to come. Yep, here we go. VRX is committed to a long-term strategy to produce the finest in 3D stereoscopic video and computer content. We have many exciting and thrilling video titles currently under development, and we'll be releasing them later in 96 and 97. We are working closely with third-party game and application programmers to develop the most comprehensive library of 3D stereoscopic software available anywhere. So, yeah, did anyone have any of these titles? You know? I don't know. Oh, it does mention, Autodesk 3D Studio, which I guess was their cyberspace project, but Autodesk 3D Studio. So I guess they're making their system compatible with the Autodesk. So, yeah, this is only a partial list. So you see, again, this is like the mid-90s. There was just this explosion in VR companies. I think Sega have their own system by this point. It's the VR1, and there was a Nintendo Virtual Boy, I think, around this time. It was all around the same time. All right. The only thing I don't have is the power supply, so I'm going to have to work one up. But this is how it worked. We got a VHS cassette. I've got to try popping that in a moment. We have cables is for RGB, and this is for composite video. I guess if you want to use it for the videotapes on your TV from the VCR, and this is the RGB module, just for the VGA graphics, which also, but both of those plug into this module, which is the piece that sits on top of the monitor or TV set, and this has the infrared LEDs in there, and this synchronizes with the video signal through an S jack on the back there. Synchronizes with the video signal, and then it sends out this infrared pulse, which synchronizes the goggles. Yep. Now I did these. These goggles, you see, I've already partially disassembled because I actually use this system quite a lot. And because I wear glasses, this is my big gripe about virtual reality systems, even going back to this first one, is that if you wear glasses, if you have to wear glasses, in my case, like if you can't wear contacts because your vision is so poor, like mine is, that contacts are not even an option, then wearing a set of goggles on top of your glasses is just, it's torture. And so I would wear my glasses behind this, and then so the virtual reality headwear, that was sitting right on like the end of my nose, like on the cartilage part of the nose, because my glasses were on the the actual bone of the nose. So this was like sitting on my cartilage. And so I really had, these are very lightweight, but they were still, they did not weigh less. It really limited my time using the goggles. You can see a little of the construction because this had this bulbous shaded sort of cover on it, which made it look really cyber cool, but it was like a 20% or 30% tinted lens, which I found, made it very hard to like really view because you're only looking, these LCD panels are flickering intermittently, so you're only looking at like half of the brightness of the monitor on at any one time because it's taking the full brightness of the monitor and splitting it between two eyes in interlaced fields. So just like watching a motion picture, a real motion picture, the brightness of the actual image has to be like twice as bright as what you're actually going to see because it's only on the screen for half the time. So using persistence of vision with the lens cover, it was just too dark. And so I took it off. It also took away some weight. But you can see here, this is the, right there is the little IR receiver right there. And two LCD panels, a little bit of hot snot, a little bit of glue here and there. This is a modification that I did because the battery would wear down and I made an external supply so I could just kind of plug in an adapter and then sling it over my ear. I think that's what I was doing. Because even though I think this is supposed to be a 1,000-hour battery, I think it took one of those 6-volt cells. Yeah, that's what it was. The battery weighed a lot, as I recall. It was one of those big 6-volts, like half AA size. It's actually a cell in there. Oh, crap. Yeah, I guess the cell is actually in there. I'm surprised it's not it didn't leak out, but there you go. That's amazing. That has been in there for, since probably about 97 at least. It's a PX28A. Wow. Duracell, look at that. No leaking, looks brand new. Oh boy. Yeah, man. I wonder if there's any voltage on that whatsoever. All right, come on, Duracell. Do you have any juice left? Is it even possible? Holy crap. Holy crap. Well, hello, hello. That is friggin' amazing. That's just, what? Really? God damn. All right, that's, wow. wow. I didn't expect that. That's okay. Now I got to go in my brain pan here. Am I having a brain fart? Did I try to fire this up in this century? I had to have. But you see, I don't have a system that would run this software because I tried to load it on a PC, the PC system. So. Boy, I'm having like a senior moment because I don't remember trying to fire this thing up at all. But that battery is good. God damn. But yeah, I can see in here I've wired in this jack to those lugs and I guess I'm using a switching. It's a switchable 1/8-inch jack. And I know I ran a power supply because I was, like I said, I was using this for gaming a lot. And it was supposed to be like 1,000 hours on a battery. And I don't think I was getting 1,000 hours quite. I ended up going to... these batteries were very expensive back at the time and hard to find. Because you have to go to like a camera store to get one. You can see some traces under there. They've been painted over. Some traces here and over here. So looks like there's some, that might be like a something on the other side. I'm gonna take off one of these and take a look. Okay, breaking the seal. I think I voided the warranty doing this. Okay. Oh, it looks like they got a flat flex in there, so I'm gonna have to take both of them off because they're joined together. You can see a cable right in there. All right, there we go. There, it's a little hot snot. All right, there we go. All right. All right, all surface mount, state of the art. Got some transistors on the side, which I would assume would be drivers for the panels. Two LCD panels, you got the little strap there between the two. And on the right side, there's the on-off button there, and got a couple of chips. One of them there is a proprietary branding, V-Rex goggles chip. Is that a PIC, maybe? Maybe a PIC chip? Hard to say. Got another one there. It's I read that on the monitor. 74HC40530. It's Decode 1995. Yeah, but that's pretty much it. That's really all it's got to do is synchronize with the infrared pulse coming from the PC monitor. I think I'm gonna leave the screws out for now because I might need to remove this to demonstrate it if I can get the software running. All right. So this is the manual, the installation guide and user's manual. Coolest wave to the third dimension. Mention. Let's see if I can use all of the all the frame for this. 3D videos playing your VCR. VCR power, just two connections, smart sync, reverse stereo feature, IR communicator, and then advanced eyewear with 1,000 hour battery, which played the VCR surfer videotape first, then follow the, so we're already breaking the rules because I haven't gotten the VCR out yet, but I will try to do that. Okay, so there's all the contents and yada yada. Like I said, I don't have the adapter. I'm going to have to make one up to fire up the transmitter. All right. Limited warranty. Breaking the warranty. Tip, did you watch the TV and VCR setup segment on your videotape? No! I have not done that. Breaking the warranty already. All right. I will try that, though. Place the transmitter, because this is the TV, so they had VHS tapes that you could play in the VCR and then use the goggles to see the 3D imagery, again using the interlaced frames of the NTSC signal. And I think, as far as I know, there's nothing in the manual here about PAL, so I guess this was only NTSC if you were going to use it with television, I think. Although, I guess it would have worked with PAL too, at a slower frame rate, but I don't know if they actually made tapes for PAL. Maybe they did. If you were in the UK or something and you actually had the VR Surfer, please leave a comment and let me know what you used to view. Yeah, go to the back of your VCR and find the driver. So it's basically telling you how to hook it up with the VCR, or if you have a cable box, get the video out, all that stuff. It's great mid-90s graphics. Check out the resolution on that. Oh yeah. How about Photoshop for Windows 3.1.1? For the win. All right. So here, yeah, this is how it works. This is the module. So in addition to having the infrared transmitter, there's also a switch in there. So it's got two little micro switches. Yeah, you can see them in there. Got one on the right and one on the left. And then you got LEDs in there, so you could use this to actually change the modes. So I guess you could power it on with the left side, and then on the right side you can switch the stereo if it's, you know, left and right. You can flip them around, I guess, until it looked like not bass backwards. Installing the battery, and there's that switch for turning on. I already showed that, and then kaboom, you're doing it. You got sharks coming at you, and you're holding your hand up to the screen in terror. Operation checklist for best results. Is it on? Is it on? Is it on? Yeah. Play tape, see green light, yeah, just dim room lights. Yeah, like I said, my one complaint about this is it just wasn't with the shaded screen on the front of the goggles. It was just too dim, which I had to tear it off. Unless you were going to burn out your phosphors by turning the brightness way up. Turn the transmitter off when not using the VR Surfer because, you know, only VR Surfer offers you 3D viewing with your TV as well as your computer at an affordable price. I think that's what was making this, like, you know, they wanted to put one of these in every home as opposed to having like a an unattainable system that you could only really get at a college or, you know, at some mega corporation. Yeah, VRX wants you to enjoy 3D stereoscopic video now. They want you to enjoy it now. Yeah. Okay. Flicker is eliminated when you install VR Surfer Advanced Mode on your computer. Again, this is because if you're watching it on VHS, you know, you're watching 30 interlaced frames instead of the 60 frames. And, you know, it would make for quite a bit of difference with using a computer monitor. I never used it with a TV. I wouldn't say it was flickerless because even with the PC, I remember it at the time, it was not flickerless. At least my PC didn't have that fast of a refresh rate. Didn't we see that before? Yeah, okay. Okay, so we're kind of back again. Okay. Screech! Stop! Play the VR Surfer videotape first, then follow the PC computer setup and this. Oh, I haven't done it. I haven't done it. I think this is actually a caricature of my friend Mert. I think it's, yeah, I don't know. Is that intentional? I don't know. Okay, computer setup. Tip, did you watch the computer setup segment on the videotape? No, I did not. Watch it yet. Okay. Put on the monitor, hook it up, plug in the thing, do the thing, plug in the other thing to the thing, and put the thing on the thing. Software setup. So there you go. Software setup. I did that yesterday. Haven't launched the software because it runs in DOS. Gonna do that next. Hopefully it will launch. We got it loaded. It took a good hour to load it all in. Which version of Windows do I have? Do I have Windows 95? Or do I have Windows 3.1? Scratch, scratch, scratch. I don't know. This is the Windows 95 setup, right? And so it's gonna, there's a, you boot up in Windows a go-to DOS app, so it's gonna run in DOS, which I kind of found out yesterday. I thought for some reason it would run in Windows, but then I realized that, you know, at the time, yeah, you didn't have the resources to run something like this on top of Windows. It would have to run in DOS. And, like, the Shockwave Assault, which I don't know if this was in a separate disk or if this actually was bundled in with the other stuff on the other CD-ROM, but I was like, maybe it would have to be another disk. But then I looked at the specs for Shockwave Assault. It's the 3D first-person shooter game. How much space do you need on your hard drive? 10 megabytes. 10 megabytes for the whole game. You gotta be kidding me. the whole game, a stereoscopic 3D first-person shooter game on 10 megabytes. Damn. You forget. I mean, it's just, you forget so much about how small programs could be back in the day and give you, like, you know, give you full color graphics like that, you know? 10 megabytes. Yeah, but I do remember playing this game. I went through it several times. Well, I guess we'll have to go through this. I tried launching it in advanced mode. It wouldn't launch. It wanted to do DOS. So, Windows 3.1. I know that I do not have a Windows 3.1 system, but it's just so cute. I really loved 3.1. In fact, I held on to it until... Did I even have a system? Well, Windows 95, I'm pretty sure. Okay, advanced mode again. Same stuff, how it works. If you want to read this, you can pause the frame at 1080p and read that if you want. Controlling your viewing environment, care and handling. Never immerse your VR software system in liquids or use cleaning solutions on the plastic parts. Store your VR software in its foam package to protect it from damage. Do not drop, throw, or abuse the VR software. Do not disassemble your VR surfer. Oh, damn. Do not disassemble. I wish I would have read that before I went and disassembled it. Okay. Do not use any power supply other than the... I'm breaking all the rules. I'm just such a bad person. Okay. Specifications. All right, 12-volt output, 12-volt DC. Okay, so yeah, I have to make up a an adapter to power this module. That's not going to be an issue. All right, the eyewear weight. Okay, the original eyewear weight, 6.1 ounces, including battery. Eyewear fits over glasses. Well, I mean, technically it did, but, you know, 6 ounces... It's not a postcard. I mean, 6 ounces on the tip of your nose, that gets kind of heavy after a while, you know. So yeah, I was pulling parts off of these goggles to strip weight, including taking the battery out, apparently. I think that's really the reason I went with the external adapter, was just to get rid of the battery weight more than anything. Because yeah, I could plug that in, put the cable over my ear, and then it's like... You know, it's probably like a good third of the weight of the goggles would be the battery. All right, and all right, system requirements: 486/33 processor or higher. Yep, a compatible SVGA display card, 1 meg video memory, 8 meg system memory, 16 meg recommended. CD-ROM drive, DOS 3.3 or higher. DOS 6.2 or DOS 7 recommended. Windows 3.1 or higher installation run on some enclosed software. Okay, but they do have some warnings. Use warning. If you feel a sense of dizziness, lightheadedness, or eye discomfort, discontinue use of the VR Surfer for a short period of time. Do not use the VR Surfer system while moving, walking, standing, driving, operating machinery, or doing anything else that requires your full attention. Driving, while driving. I mean, that would be hardcore, but I guess they had to warn you not to try it. And not to operate heavy machinery while operating your PC VR system. So I guess if you're, you know, if you're working a steam press, it's best to put down the goggles before operating the steam press. Epilepsy warning. Some people are sensitive to stroboscopic or flashing visual displays. If you experience discomfort or disorientation when using the VR system, discontinue use. Well, we read that right on the tin, as it were. So, FCC compliance, troubleshooting, yada yada. If you're having problems, we're going to have lots of problems. Need more help? If you want to try calling them, be my guest, you know. If you want to try emailing him, be my guest, but I don't think you're gonna really find him. Could try faxing him, though. Maybe the fax line still works. Okay, 1996 V-Rex. So there you go. Fully informed. Even got the special order form for stuff coming out. Oh, here we go. Prices. Yep. So North American version, $99.95, so less than $100. International, $119.95 US bucks in 1995. Eyewear only, $49.95 domestic or $59.95 international. All right. $7 for each VR Surfer Retreat 8 priority mail in the US, $15 to Canada, $30 in 1995. For each VR Surfer outside the continental United States. But again, I would run on NTSC, unless you're just running it on PC. There you go. And that's dated October 96. So, all right. I've been trying to get this set up for a few hours now. I got this 1080p recorder. And it'll record, I got it to do like monitor shots and stuff, but it will not work with my upscaler. So if I'm going from analog video like this, with this little upscaler thingy, it will not record. I don't know, I think it's something to do with like CopyGuard and the HDMI. Like you have to have like a certain kind of signal in the HDMI for it to allow recording or something to that. It's some kind of like CopyGuard thing, but the upscaler that I have for going from analog video, I have not been able to get any. I've gone through 4 HDMI recorders in the last few months, and I've sent them all back because none of them would work on all of my HDMI. But yeah, I don't know what the deal is with that. All right, so let's see if we can make this work. So I got to shoot over my shoulder with my other camera. make this a lot more complicated than I wanted to, with a lot less resolution. So, okay, so we gotta go to Programs, Surfer, and then we want to go to DOS Apps. I still got the disk in there, so. All right, that didn't work. Okay, let's see here. When else fails, read the manual. All right. That. Okay, well, it's there. Yeah. Just doesn't tell you how to launch it. Okay. Good old command line for the win. G. Or any exe. Let's see. Of course. Well, this doesn't seem so straightforward how to actually launch the software. All right, that won't. Okay, now I cancel it. Won't run that. So let's see here. Go to frickin' Programs, frickin' VR Surfer, frickin'. So I got all this stuff like 3D control panel. It says VR BIOS not detected. VR BIOS should be loaded from your auto exec file before Windows starts. See the troubleshooting section and guide. Oh, online. Well, that's great. Troubleshooting. Okay. No, there's nothing on here about loading problems. Nothing at all. Online manual. Ah! Here we go. How to contact VREX. let's see here. Page down. My page down. Your Surfer. Click on the application you wish to run. Well, it won't run any of these. Fuck all. I'm just wasting time here. Ah! Alright, command line for the win. Okay, let's see if this works. Whoa! We're in! Yes! We are in! Okay. Let's go to the demo. VR demo. Just hit V. Right. No driver. No driver. I guess the driver's incompatible. Oh, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Doodle? Before using advanced mode, the system must first be configured, yada yada. Online, everything. Ah, okay. It's the VR. So this driver must be incompatible with Windows ME. So it must only run on a 95 or a 3.1 system. So these are all the images that are in here. Yeah, see, they're all interlaced. Okay. Yep. I'm just wasting tape, even though there's no tape. Yeah, it's just going around and around. So it looks like it's just not going to run anything here. All right, well, I guess that's it. Let's at least take a look at some of these backdrops. All right, so yeah, there's the interlaced fields. Yeah. I know, it looks like, even though this is for PC, it looks like it's set up to scale with NTSC for like the number of lines. I really wish I could have got this to run. It really kind of sucks. Right. Well, actually, I'm just going through Windows here rather than going through the application and hit the demo. And there you go. That's, I guess that's just this interlaced still. And again, if I had the goggles hooked up, that would just be a test, so that seems to work. I'm gonna see if I can launch something else here, something animated. Pointer, Porsche. This loader is invoked and required by border tools. Okay. No driver. All right. All right, yes. I got something. It's cranking. Ooh. So I guess this is like a paint program. Doesn't seem to be working. So that's a paint program in 3D. Oh, no. No. Doesn't know what any of these are. Oh. That's just... Oh! Oh, here's cool. All right. Let's maximize that. All right. How about that? That's pretty cool. Can we change rotation? Ooh, okay. Oh, look at that. That's something. Change perspective on that. All right. Oh, look. Oh, that, now there's something. All right. That's really cool. So this is interesting. You can build 3D models in here, and then this isn't actually interlaced. So I guess you would build 3D models like in a, 3D CAD program here. And once you build your solids, you would just convert them, I guess, and then you choose the glasses. Like if I chose this, which it would just give me an error, but you could do this instead of having like the 2D perspective, it would interlace it and give you the goggle version. Well, that's actually pretty cool, and that still works. But again, that driver won't run on Windows ME, so yeah, I really need just a Windows 95 system, really. Let's try man. Okay. All right. These are, again, this is pretty cool. You know, for 95, this would have been pretty stunningly impressive, especially seeing in stereoscopic vision. So, that ain't too bad. Well, I guess we'll call this partial success. I don't know. I guess I really need like a proper Windows 95 or 3.1.1 system to really run this, because the driver will not run on ME. At least I can't get it to recognize the driver. So, you know, if I do come across a proper antiquated system, even though the last thing in the world that I want is another antique computer system. But if I had a Windows 95 computer, not that I would want to use it for anything else, then I maybe could run this. And but then, you know, I don't know. I mean, how would I show you how the goggles work and everything? I mean, they're going to be blinky blinky. I don't know if I could really even demonstrate how this works. But it would have been cool to have like some of the animation running and everything, and at least to be able to show the interlaced fields and stuff and how it worked, you know, with the system. But anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. Thanks for watching. I don't know how long this is. I've been working on this for 2 days, so it's like a whole bunch of a lot of stuff for nothing. But thank you. Thanks too to all of the patrons. They're on that Patreon thing that are making all these videos possible. It's true. If you like what I do, if you liked this video for some reason, then, you know, consider becoming a patron. It's real easy to do. You just go to the link in the description and become a patron of that there Fran Lab. And I will thank you personally. Okay, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll be back here real soon doing something else. All right. Bye! Berserk in my lab. It's where I work.
VREX welcomes you to the world of stereoscopic 3D. Congratulations on your purchase of the VR Surfer, VREX's revolutionary new way to see stereoscopic 3D on your TV and computer. With sophisticated microprocessor electronics, unique low power circuits which give you 1,000 hours of battery life, and an innovative breakthrough called Smart Sync technology that lets you use the same infrared communication with your TV and PC, you now have the latest and most thrilling way to see stereoscopic 3D. This video cassette contains the following information. How to connect the VR Surfer to your TV and VCR. Stereoscopic video demonstration and sampler. How to install the VR Surfer on your computer. Create your own stereoscopic presentations. other V-Rex stereoscopic products. Please watch this portion of the videotape first, where you will see how to set up the VR Surfer with your TV and VCR. Then you can stop the tape and refer to the enclosed installation guide to connect the VR Surfer to your VCR. Remove everything from the box and place it on the table grouped as we will show you. In addition to the installation guide, you should have CD-ROM software, which includes instructions on how to install configurations and all the 3D utilities on your computer and some awesome 3D games. A videotape, which includes setup instructions, 3D animations, and 3D documentaries. VR Surfer 3D eyewear. Transmitter, which uses patented technology to communicate wirelessly to the eyewear. Power adapter for transmitter. VR Surfer TV cable with Y-splitter. VR Surfer computer cable. Notice that for your convenience and ease of connection, the cables have been color-coded. Since you'll be setting up the VR Surfer with your TV first, set aside the VR Surfer computer cable and the CD-ROM software. You'll use them to set up the computer later. Here's the VR Surfer setup to display 3D on your TV. As you can see, there are only two simple connections. One to power the transmitter, and the other to bring video signals from your VCR to the transmitter. First, place the transmitter on top of your TV as shown, with the lip securing it on the edge. Plug the power adapter into an outlet and the power cable into the smaller socket at the rear of the transmitter. Locate the video out jack on the back of your VCR. VCRs are different, and there may be many cables attached. Simply find the one jack labeled video out. It's usually yellow. Plug the Y-splitter end of the VR Surfer TV cable labeled to VCR video out and color-coded yellow into video out on the back of your VCR. Should video out already have a cable plugged into it, unplug that cable and plug in the Y-splitter side of the VR Surfer TV cable in its place. Plug the cable you removed back into the other open end of the Y-splitter. Take the other end of the VR Surfer TV cable, which is labeled to transmitter, color-coded gray, and plug the 4-pin plug into the larger socket at the rear of the transmitter. The pins should line up carefully with the socket so that they don't get bent. Use the red dots on both the cable and the transmitter to help align them. A red power light on the left side of the transmitter lens comes on each time it's plugged in, and the power light will turn green when the SmartSync circuit detects a video signal. Pressing the left front side of the cover lens turns the transmitter off and on. Pressing the right side of the lens switches between reverse stereo, indicated by a yellow light, and stereo, which is indicated when the light is off. For normal operation with all V-Rex video, the yellow light should be off. Now you're ready to surf the third dimension with some exciting 3D stereoscopic video. Turn on your TV and VCR. Place the V-Rex 3D video cassette into your VCR and you'll see the green light, letting you know that the transmitter has detected and is sending the 3D signal. The infrared signal is sent from the transmitter to the eyewear, so make sure the transmitter is on top of the TV, directly facing you, so the eyewear will receive the signal. Turn on the VR Surfer eyewear by pressing the white button on the inner left side. The lenses will be flashing to indicate they are on. Now you are ready to watch 3D stereoscopic video. Turn off the room lights to minimize interference and flicker. Sit back, put on the VR Surfer, start playing the video cassette in your VCR, and enjoy. You'll see some exciting 3D video which uses the VR Surfer video display mode. You'll find that when you install the VR Surfer on your computer, you will experience improved resolution and picture stability in the VR Surfer's basic display mode. The flicker will be eliminated when you choose the VR Surfer advanced mode on your computer. Only the VR Surfer offers all of these display modes for any 3D application on both your TV and computer. At the conclusion of the 3D video presentation, we'll show you how to connect and install the VR Surfer on your computer. Stop this tape now and follow the instructions in the TV and VCR section of the installation guide. Stereoscopic 3D video puts you on location to witness exotic people, places, and events. See circus performers rehearsing for a trapeze extravaganza.
kayak and canoe with nationally ranked competitors on Colorado's Crystal River. From the video series, A Year on the Road, travel to a festival of traditional regional dances in Oaxaca, Mexico. A peyote cleansing ceremony performed by the shaman or medicine man of the Huichol Indians from the mountains of central Mexico. Join us in the streets of Chichicastenango, Guatemala. Let 3D videotapes from V-Rex and Ray 3D bring the world to you in your own living room.
Before connecting the VR Surfer to your computer, make sure your computer and monitor are turned off. You'll need both the VR Surfer computer cable and the CD-ROM which was set aside earlier. When you remove the transmitter from the top of the TV, you can leave the VR Surfer TV cable connected to the VCR for future use, especially if it's hard to get to. Here's the VR Surfer setup to display 3D on your computer. As you can see, there are only two simple connections, one to power the transmitter and the other to bring the computer monitor signals to the transmitter. Place the transmitter on top of your computer monitor with the lip securing it on the edge. Plug the power adapter into an outlet and the power cable into the smaller socket at the rear of the transmitter. Trace the monitor cable and remove it from the computer monitor port. Take the VR Surfer computer cable and plug the end labeled "to computer monitor port" into the computer monitor port. Plug the monitor cable into the back of the VR Surfer computer cable. Now take the 4-pin end of the VR Surfer computer cable, labeled 2 transmitter, and plug it into the large socket at the rear of the transmitter. Avoid bending the pins by making sure the red dots on the cable and transmitter are aligned. The red power light on the left side of the transmitter lens comes on each time it is plugged in, and will turn green when the computer is in 3D mode. Pressing the left front side of the cover lens turns the transmitter off and on. For computer use, pressing the right side of the lens switches between stereo and reverse stereo modes, which is indicated by the yellow light. Begin your software installation by turning off the yellow light if it is on. You'll be prompted during installation if it's necessary to operate with the yellow light on. Now make sure the transmitter is on top of the monitor facing squarely forward. It is now safe to turn on your computer and monitor. To install the VR Surfer software from the CD-ROM, have your computer ready in Windows 3.1 or Windows 95. Check the Windows screens if you don't know which Windows version you have. Pop in the VR Surfer CD-ROM and follow the on-screen installation instructions. Install basic mode first. However, we urge you to eventually configure the advanced mode to eliminate flicker and improve graphics resolution. It will take several minutes for the VR Surfer program to be installed. Once the program has been installed, and before you reboot, remove the CD-ROM from the drive. Turn on your VR Surfer eyewear, pressing the white button located on the inner left side. Your glasses have a convenient power-saving feature, so if they do not receive a stereo signal for about 2 minutes, they will turn off automatically. It may be necessary to press the button again during installation. Once you've experienced the VR Surfer on your computer, return to the following portion of the videotape to see how V-Rex can meet your needs for 3D stereoscopic imaging. You can now stop this tape and follow the instructions in the computer section of the installation guide. V-Rex has included user-friendly software on the CD-ROM to allow you to create vivid, colorful 3D graphics that leap from the screen with true stereo presence, just as easily as you now create 2D images. Stereo VR expands your world with spectacular 3D and stereoscopic animations. Convert your ideas and designs into high-quality stereo animation with Stereo VR. Simply use the VR Surfer with the Easy Animation feature to instantly bring objects right out of your monitor. Muxit offers a point-and-click environment to provide a fast and convenient way to convert 3D graphics from MS Excel, MATLAB, MathCAD, and many other programs into stereoscopic 3D right from your Windows clipboard. 3D Backdrops, another V-Rex exclusive, is a collection of bitmapped backdrops that can be loaded into programs such as MS PowerPoint for more powerful lectures, seminars, and sales meetings. V-Rex, a world leader in stereoscopic technology, invented micropole optics, which makes the transition from flat imaging to 3D stereoscopic imaging possible. The exclusive V-Rex line of affordable products provides the benefit of stereoscopic vision to customers such as IBM, Merck, ITT, NYU Medical Center, GE, and NASA. Stereoscopic LCD panels, projectors, interactive kiosks, video cameras, notebook computers, and immersive environments from V-Rex are ready to create and display images in stereoscopic 3D, the way nature meant us to see the world. V-Rex 3D stereoscopic overhead projection panels display live video or computer-generated stereoscopic 3D stills and animation. Plug any PC, Mac, or notebook computer into the panel and project your 2D or 3D creations to audiences large and small. And because all V-Rex 3D displays have unique patented micropole optics, outfitting any size audience with passive 3D glasses is inexpensive. V-Rex offers the world's only compact, totally integrated 3D stereoscopic LCD projectors that let you bring your 3D shows and demos anywhere. With complete multimedia capabilities, they eliminate the expense and inconvenience of dual projectors or bulky CRT projectors used in other systems. V-Rex introduced the world's only stereoscopic notebook computer. The Cyberbook lets you create and view exciting 3D presentations anywhere, anytime, while maintaining its 2D performance. Available in PC or Mac platforms, the innovative Cyberbook uses existing 3D software to render and display your creations. You can produce your own 3D videos with the V-Rex Cam 3000, the only affordable 3D stereoscopic video camera that lets you create exciting live-action stereo indoors or out the first time you use it. Custom products from V-Rex include the Ultimate Multimedia Information Center, the VR Kiosk, an interactive stereo display for shopping malls, retail stores, reception areas, airports, and an immersive environment, the VR Cove, which surrounds you with a 180-degree panoramic stereo view, putting you at the center of the action. Stereoscopic 3D is the natural way we see the world, and V-Rex can give you the ability to create and project that vision, with products and a library of software that will fit your unique need for 3D stereoscopic imaging.
Fudge. Only I didn't say fudge. I said the word. The F-dash-dash-dash word.